and you're listening to my favorite talk show, the Beatly Show with Aditya.
NatWest Trophy 2002, or as pseudo experts like to call it, an era not yet corrupted by the 20 over version. Good old days, an era where it was all about ancient day cricket. Discussions like the size of the ground, state of the pitch, whether it is a belter or whether it will help bowlers as well as batters equally, where there was no discussion on this particular sport was heavily tilted in the batter's favor, the batsman's favor, where there was no discussion on how whether a leg spinner should not be bowling to a left hander because of the smaller boundaries, or whether an off spinner should not be bowling to a right hander, where such frivolous discussion hadn't yet penetrated a commentator's daily discussion, nor was it in the passive stakeholders like the media as well as other individuals. NatWest Trophy, it was the final of that tournament. India and England had made their way into the tournament after playing well in the round robin matches. India were supposed to chase 325 runs in 50 overs. Remember, this was 18 years ago, where the 20 over version hadn't yet penetrated, which meant that the confidence of scoring 300 plus wasn't as high as it is today, where there is the confidence to not only score 400 runs as the first innings of a match, but it is also possible to chase 400 runs in the second inning. So yes, 325 runs 18 years ago was a big deal for the Indian team. And then came the shock. Dravid, Tendulkar, Ganguly, Sehwag, they all were dismissed. India were 146 for 5, still needing those elusive 180 runs to win the tournament. Now in 2002, as you all know, the focus was on the likes of Sehwag, Dravid, Tendulkar and Ganguly. And if these marquee players were dismissed, then India had no chance of winning a match. But two relatively young men in the team shocked the entire world when they chased that total of 325 with such an ease. At the time, Yuvraj at 20.5 and Mohammad Kaif at 21.5 were both semi-fringe players. Means that they were not a certainty in the team. Yes, they were there, but they could be dropped if they did not perform because other players were waiting in the wings to replace them. So this tournament changed the way we looked at a certain Yuvraj Singh, who then went on to be a part of the team for the next 15 years. For those who do remember this match, who put it part of their emotional archives, it was the famous shirt-waving antics by the former captain Sourav Ganguly, which was an answer to Andrew Flintoff's own shirt-waving tactics a year earlier when England beat India to square a tournament 3-all. Chasing that total of 325 brought about a huge change in the way we viewed the sport, especially from the point of view of India. Because before we designated MS Dhoni as the finisher, Yuvraj was doing that role with aplomb, and he became the first ever proper finisher as far as this sport is concerned. And also Yuvraj and Kaif led the fielding revolution as far as the Indian fielding is concerned, because in the pre-2000 era, Indian fielding was the weakest point. Till 2000, Indian fielding was its weakest point. Fast forward to the year 2020. Influence of T20 or the 20 over version has brought about a macabre change as far as the lingo of the commentators are concerned. They only talk about the size of the ground, whether the leg spinner of the off spinner is bowling the dusras, the googlies, the wrong ones, whether the fast bowlers are bowling the knuckleball, the slower bouncer and other such deliveries in that armory, where the term modern day cricket or modern day sports is being used frequently. Australia 70 for 5, having lost 5 of their marquee batters in Marcus Stoinis, David Warner, Aaron Finch, Mitchell Marsh and Marnus Labuschagne. Alex Carey and Glenn Maxwell are on the crease. The total is 73 for 5. They need to make 300 runs to win the tournament. Two semi-fringe players are on the crease in Alex Carey and Glenn Maxwell. Alex Carey is yet to make and cement his place with a worthy performance. Remember, in this sport, unless you score at least 100 runs, you're not worthy of being counted as a main player. On the other hand is Glenn Maxwell, a good player, a player with lot of capabilities, a player who has the ability to turn the game on its head, but he hasn't come up with a performance to do that. And now with his wicket-keeping partner Alex Carey, he has to do something impossible. Comments which might have taped all of Glenn Maxwell's critics about his performances, as well as put Alex Carey on the main frame as far as Australian players and our obsession with the players of the past are concerned. Few Puritan experts will not like to compare these two matches because two matches were in an era which were like chalk and cheese. Eventually it happened. The Indian 20 over domestic World Cup starts tomorrow, a tournament which the entire world is looking forward to despite the presence of other tournaments of other sports. It's the NBA, the NFL, the NHL or other such marquee tournaments, or even the various football tournaments. There is one song which aptly describes all these franchisee-based international domestic tournaments. Paisa ye paisa, paisa hai kaisa, hi koi aisa jaisa ye paisa, ke musibat na ho musibat, ho musibat na ho, but 7, 8, 9, 10, paisa ye paisa, paisa hai kaisa, nahi koi aisa jaisa ye paisa, ke hum musibat na ho musibat, ha musibat na ho, musibat 7, 8, 9, 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, prem dekha pyar dekha, yaari dekhi yaar dekha, prem dekha pyar dekha, yaari dekhi yaar dekha, dil ke aat paar dekha, दूर पास मौसम है एक जैसा, पैसा 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 ये पैसा, पैसा ये पैसा, पैसा है कैसा, नहीं कोई ऐसा जैसा ये, 7, 8, 9, 10, लाला 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 लाला, पैसा ये पैसा, पैसा है कैसा, नहीं कोई ऐसा जैसा ये पैसा, के मुसीबत ना हो मुसीबत, हो मुसीबत ना हो मुसीबत, 7, 8, 9, 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Who will win this year's Indian T20 Domestic World Cup? Will it be 4 times champion Mumbai Heat, or will we have a new winner in Bangalore Renegades, Punjab Sixers, Delhi Strikers? Only teams who haven't won the tournament yet. First match is between last year's winners Mumbai Heat and their opponents in the final, Chennai. Though the question is, how will a crowd-less tournament affect the players? It is a universal truth that the audience does have a psychological effect on the performance of the players. There have been ample discussions as to how an empty arena will affect the massive ego of a few players. Well, that shall be known once the tournament starts. For now, the players are huddled in their own bubble, which means that until the match starts, opposing teams can't meet each other. There can be no interaction between the broadcasters and the officials and the players. They will have to have conversations using pseudo-artificial intelligence devices. Is there any emotional connect between the players and the tournament and between the players and the team management? For me, there is no emotional connect. It's all about using this tournament as a source of revenue, as a source of employment. Pro experts have been espousing that teams like Delhi, Punjab, Bangalore got the right combination of players, all-rounders and captains to take this tournament and surprise everyone by having a new winner and moving on from the likes of Mumbai and Chennai. Two individuals will say that even Hyderabad has a chance, but let me tell you, Hyderabad has won the tournament twice. They were known as Deccan Chargers, and can this be the year of Virat Kohli, who at the end of the tournament would be able to say with pride that at least I have won one major competition as a captain, even if it is only domestic World Cup. There's a big difference between selecting the players and converting that team selection into a victory. That's something that only happens once the tournament starts and once the team performs. So getting excited about the players in each of the teams, the new selections, the old hands, is something that should be held back until the tournament begins. It is not the first time a tournament was shifted to Dubai. Happened in 2014, but at that time the Indian Cricket Board didn't think much about it. They didn't have to do deliberations of 6 months whether it will happen, it will not happen, whether what will be the revenue loss if the tournament doesn't happen. Well, at this point there are 8 teams. They all have come up with their respective plans to win the tournament. So I would give each team 12.5% each. For me, no team is at any advantage because of the team they have selected, because of the marquee players they have in their team. The Wasteland by T.S. Eliot. There I saw one I knew and stopped him, crying, "Stetson, you who were with me in the ships at Mylae, that corpse you planted last year in your garden, has it begun to sprout? Will it bloom this year, or has the sudden frost disturbed its bed? Oh, keep the dog far hence, that's friend to men, or with his nails he'll dig up again. Yon semblable mon frère." The chair she sat in like a burnished throne, wrought on the marble where the glass held up by standards wrought with fruited vines from which a golden cupidon peeped out, her hid his eyes behind his wing. Double the flames of 7-branched candelabra reflecting light upon the table as the glitter of her jewels rose to meet it. From satin cases poured in rich profusion, in vials of ivory and colored glass, unstopped lurked her strange synthetic perfumes, Unguent, powered or liquid. Troubled, confused and drowned the sense in odors stirred by the air that freshened from the window. These ascended in fattening the prolonged candle flames, flung their smoke into the laquera, stirring the pattern on the coffered ceiling. Huge seawood fed with copper, burnt green and orange, framed by the colored stone in which sat like a carved dolphin swam. Above the antique mantle was displayed, as though a window gave upon the sylvan scene, the change of Philomel by the barbarous king, so rudely forced. Yet there the nightingale filled all the desert with her inviolable voice. And still she cried, and still the world pursues, jug, jug to dirty ears. And other withered stumps of time were told upon the walls. Starring forms leaned out, leaning, hushing the room enclosed. Footsteps shuffled on the stair. Under the firelight, under the brush, her hair spread out in fiery points, glowed into words, then would be savagely still. Homer's Iliad, Book 1. But the swift runner Achilles answered him at once. Just how Agamemnon, great field marshal, most grasping man alive? How can the generous Argives give you prizes now? I know of no troves of treasure piled, lying idle. Anyway, whatever we dragged from towns we plundered, all's been portioned out, but collected, call it back from the rank and file? That would be the disgrace. So return the girl to the god, at least for now. We Achaeans will pay you back 3-4 times over, if Zeus will grant us the gift, somehow, someday, to raise Troy's massive ramparts to the ground. King Agamemnon countered, not so quickly, brave as you are, godlike Achilles, trying to cheat me? Oh no, you won't get past me, take me in that way. What do you want, to cling to your own prize? While I sit calmly by, empty-handed here? Is that why you order me to give her back? No, if our generous Argives will give me a prize, a match for my desire, equal to what I have lost, well and good. But if they give me nothing, I will take a prize myself, your own or Ajax's or Odysseus' prize. Commandeer her myself and let that man I go to visit choke with rage. Enough. We'll deal with all this later in due time. Now come, we'll haul a black ship down to the bright sea, gather a decent number of oarsmen along her locks and put aboard a sacrifice, and Chersey herself in all her beauty. We embark her too. Let one of the leading captains take command. Ajax, Idomeneus, trusty Odysseus, or you, Achilles, you the most violent man alive, so you can perform the rites for us and calm the god yourself. P.G. Woodhouse, stiff upper lip, Jeeves. You, I said, that's me, he replied, my last year at school, I skipped the side that season. That old scrubby willoughby sitting next to me. Fast swing three quarter, but never would learn to give the reverse pass. He wouldn't, I said, shocked. I hadn't the remotest what he was talking about, but he had said enough to show me that this Willoughby must have been a pretty dubious character, and when he went on to tell me that poor old Scrubby had died of cirrhosis of the liver in the federal Malay states, I wasn't really surprised. I imagine these fellows who won't learn to give the reverse pass generally come to a fairly sticky end. Chap on my other side is Smiler Todd, prop forward, and a very good one. Played for Cambridge later on. You fond of rugger? I don't think I know him. Rugby football. No, I have never gone in for it. You haven't? No. Good God. I could see that I had sunk pretty low in his estimation, but he was a horse and managed to fight down the feeling of nausea with which my confession had afflicted him. I have always been mad keen on rugger. Didn't get much of it after leaving school as they stationed me in West Africa. Tried to teach the natives there the game, but had to give it up. Too many deaths, with the inevitable subsequent blood feuds. Retired now and settled down here. I'm trying to make Hockleycum Meston the best football village in these parts, and I will say for the lads that they are coming on nicely. What we need is a good prop forward, and I can't find one. But you don't want to hear all this. You want to know about my Brazilian expedition. Oh, have you been to Brazil? I seem to have said the wrong thing, as one often does. He said, didn't you know I had been to Brazil? No one tells me anything. I should have thought they would have briefed you at the office. Seems silly to send a reporter all the way down here without telling him what they are sending him for. I am pretty astute, and I saw there had been a mix-up somewhere. Were you expecting a reporter? Of course I was. Aren't you from the Daily Express? Sorry, no. I thought you must be the chap who was coming to interview me about my Brazilian explorations. Again, I said the wrong thing. He was plainly piqued. What did you think I was? Does the name Blank mean nothing to you? Your name Blank? Of course it is. Well, what a very odd coincidence. I said, intrigued, I am looking for a character called Blank. Not you, somebody else. The bimbo I want is a sturdy tiller of the soil, probably gnarled with a sailor son. As you have the same name as him, you will probably be interested in the story I am about to relate. I have here, I said, producing the black amber thing or what not. He gaped at it. Where did you get that? That's the bit of native sculpture I picked up on the Congo and then sold it to Sir Watkin Passe. I was amazed. You sold it to him? Certainly. Well, shiver my timbers. I was conscious of a boy scoutful glow. I liked this plank and I rejoiced that it was in my power to do him as good a turn as anyone had ever done anybody. God bless Bertram Wooster. Felt he would be saying in another couple of ticks. For the first time, I was glad that Stiffy had sent me on this mission.
more awesome content, tune in to the next episode of The Weekly Show with Aditya.